live here on GIP TV. Just kind of pretend you're back in the classroom, find a quiet place, get your earbuds on, and we're going to continue with the Great Depression. We're going to the year of 1932, where there is an election between Franklin Delano Roosevelt, the governor of New York, and incumbent president Herbert Hoover. Hoover's had a lot of problems in the last 4 years, and although he tried to fix the Depression, it was getting worse. Remember where we left off. Banks were failing, the stock market was not really working, and people were losing a lot of money, and the signs around this country of total Great Depression were in full sight. People looking for jobs, people moving out of houses they couldn't afford to live in, people camping in these shack villages they called Hoovervilles. So where Herbert Hoover was when we last left off was he was in trouble. And I really did compare him to the Bridgestone tire commercial that I'm going to insert here, where he just didn't know where to go. The squirrel's in the middle of the road, it sees the car coming, and it just doesn't know which way to go. So let's take a look at that one again, okay?
For drivers who want to get the most out of their cars, it's Bridgestone or nothing.
So the people choose, and in 42 states, Franklin Delano Roosevelt wins the election of 1932. A big change. And also, if you look at the map, you can see that he only won a few states in the New England area. He won New York and lots of others. Alaska and Hawaii were not states at that time. And if you look at the electoral vote count, it is a staggering loss. We haven't had something like that in quite a long time. So that's where they stand. And unfortunately, I'd have to say for that squirrel, sorry, Hoover, it didn't work out too well. History will judge him differently sometimes, and also as a faulty president, not doing enough. So if you get into your research and look at what Hoover did do and what didn't do, that's an interesting topic for conversation. Anyway, let's move on to Franklin Delano Roosevelt. And when he gives his inaugural address, he comes across as bold, as a person who's ready to make things change, and says a few things that go down in history as famous quotes. The biggest one was, we have nothing to fear but fear itself. So think about that a minute. There's a lot of problems, but he's saying the only thing we have to fear is fear. And I always tell this story in class about, you know, watching a scary movie or something and then being up late, going to bed, and then waking up in the middle of the night and having to go to the bathroom. And feeling like, oh my God, I don't know if I can make that. There's going to be something there. Something's going to get me. And when you look at that moment, it's pretty scary. It's almost paralytic, you know? You can't move. But you know that there's nothing there. You just got to take that one foot and get it on the floor and take another foot. So what Roosevelt is trying to say is, don't let your fear paralyze you. Make that trip to the bathroom. Nothing's going to get you. And the same thing with what's going on. You've got to act. You've got to keep trying to find a job. You've got to look for solutions. And as president, he's going to do whatever the government possibly can to get this depression started on the right track and getting us out of it. So we'll talk about some of his plans as well. Franklin Delano Roosevelt. Let's go to stick figure theater here, which is something we usually draw in class, but I'll go ahead and illustrate it for you. So if you take a look at the next slide, and I'll try to get these embedded, Franklin Roosevelt becomes president in 1932. And I drew him with the leg braces to remind you of his polio, and it was kept hidden from most people. The media agreed not to take pictures and not to show him getting out of cars. You can find some footage, and I put some on there that are, you know, very rare. But the way that Roosevelt decided to communicate was by radio. Movies were there, and newsreels, which were little clips of movies, were shown in theaters before the main film. But he chose to do something that was known as a fireside chat, where families would gather around their radio and Roosevelt would speak. I imagine him speaking in the White House in front of a fireplace, and that may or may not be true. But what he did was he took on different issues. And what people remember most about the presidency of Roosevelt and his fireside chats were the way that people felt like he was talking directly to them. Very different from Herbert Hoover. Older people felt like he understood what was going on. Younger people felt, even though they weren't involved in some of the problems that their parents were, that he was talking to them, and it was going to be a great, spectacular adventure to get out of this and to do it together. So people listened by their radios, the encouraging words of Franklin Roosevelt. Also, what he established was something that was called a brain trust. And a brain trust is really a nickname that was given to the smart people he called to the White House to work with him in the executive branch. I see it like a football coach. You know, the coach has a lot of responsibilities, but they can't do it all, and they're not experts in everything. In football, you have an offensive line coach, a defensive line coach, special teams coaches. You have all sorts of people who are experts at certain things that will go and research those things, whether it's looking at game films or whatever, and come back to the president and give them solutions, and it's the president's call. You know, if you look at theater, you have a director, but you also have choreographers, and you have lighting people, and you have people who work on the script and revisions and the writers. So, you know, to take all of those people separately and say, go do the best job you can, and then report back to me, and I'm going to make the decisions on which way we go, that's known as Roosevelt's brain trust. So, you know, that's a very important thing. When communicating with the American people, his first 100 days, he was a man of action and decided that the best way to communicate his programs, things that would become bills and eventually signed into law, he chose to use abbreviations, very small 3 or 4 letter abbreviations for larger named programs. They became known as the alphabet soup kind of programs, and we're going to talk about many of them, looking at some of them on the Stick Figure Theater. We have AAA and SEC and FDIC, and they were all directed at different things that the government was going to get going. We'll look specifically at FDIC and the banks. Oh, phone call. All right, hold on a sec. Anyway, those were abbreviations that became common in the language of Americans. And if you were listening to Fireside Chats and following along, you knew what they standed for and who they were targeting. When Roosevelt had to make action and call the first play of the game, other than assuring the American people, was to fix the banking system. The banking system was broken. People did not put their money in banks. Businesses did not put their money in banks because banks were closing and people were losing their savings. They were hiding money under their bed and in their walls, and nobody really trusted them anymore. And Roosevelt looked at the banking system like our circulatory system. You know, if you don't have blood flowing to all the organs and the brains and things like that, it's not going to be a functioning body. And to fix the banking system was the first in his many plans in his first 100 days. The initials FDIC became very important. I'll get to that in a second. But a bank holiday was declared. And around the country, any banks that were still functioning were looked at by the government. They went to the banks. They looked at what was in the vault. They looked at their organization and what was being run and decided to not open banks that were considered failures and that could not be fixable, but to open banks on one condition that could function again, and that is that they bought government insurance for the depositors. It's an initial program known as FDIC. FDIC was the government's way of insuring depositors. The banks would have to pay insurance. It would cost them a lot of money. They'd have to follow rules and regulations about how much money was kept in the vault and how people could get a loan without risk to the bank and to the depositors. And this program was created to make people feel like they could take their money out of their mattresses and in their walls and in their cookie jars and put it back into the banks. Fireside chats were delivered on this, and the results are stunning. People actually did put money back into the banks. Now, between the time that the banks were closed and it was decided which ones were open, we had what was called a bank holiday for 4 days in this country, 4 weekdays. Banks were not open. And during those 4 days, if you had money, that was fine. But if you didn't, there was a lot of bartering and trading going on for goods and services. You may agree to watch somebody's children for the day while they went to look for jobs in exchange for food from their garden, or maybe to borrow bicycles or something like that, where you would get an exchange instead of paying for services. So that was an important thing. It's important to know that in Roosevelt's banking crisis legislation, it's still around today. And our money is insured. If you go to any bank, you'll see some sort of federal insurance deposit corporation logo somewhere. It's a little different for credit unions, but for banks, the way that it works is you can see how much you are insured up to. It had been for a long time $250,000, so that if anything happened to the bank and it had to close, the government would pay what you had in the bank. Very much like car insurance. You know, you're paying a little bit of money, and if you get into an accident, the insurance company will pay for the cost of the accident and possibly, depending on your insurance, replacement of your vehicle or to get things fixed. So kind of in that sense. But if you look at the political cartoon where you see Roosevelt in the bank window and the hoarding of money, and that's what he called it, hoarding money at home, it needs to be in the economy, the hoarding started to end. And that cartoon really kind of shows the power that his legislation and his encouragement to Americans got money back in the banks and things were flowing again. The last thing I want to show you here is a graph where he takes over in 1932. You can see that the amount of banks that were closing was huge. But then that graph just takes a huge tumble of bank closures. And you can see that the numbers are very, very low, even under 1%. The other thing that that measures in the graph are farm foreclosures. And a foreclosure is when you lose your property. And that was at a very, very high level in 1932, 1933. And then over the next bunch of years comes down considerably. So the banking legislation in the 100 days was extremely important. Okay, how about getting people back to work? And you know, we see this now. There's people who aren't working because of the coronavirus, and people aren't bringing home paychecks. And that's very scary to some people. Some of Roosevelt's programs were directed at fixing the work, and that government would be putting people back to work. They're gonna raise taxes, and they're gonna borrow money, and things are going to happen. Follow the news right now, and you'll see that there's a lot of stuff going on with giving families money in this time of crisis. So money and work was also something that was important. Excuse the person in the background, they're making breakfast. Anyway, let's move on to one of the most popular programs. It was called the Civilian Conservation Corps. And the CCC for short became a real popular program. It hired young men from their late teens until their early 20s. And they worked for the government, kind of like in the army. You know, you go there and you live in tents and you eat together and you go on different projects. They're known for things like making a lot of parks. There's one in New York called Gilbert Lake, where they paved trails and made pavilions and campground sites. So all over the country, the young men of the CCC were working. They were sending most of their money home to their families, and the government was paying for their food and for other things that they needed. But it became a very popular program. Green Lake State Park, many of those buildings that are still around there, those foundations were built during that time by the CCC, the Civilian Conservation Corps. Some of the things that he did were extremely bold, and some worked and some didn't. But the point that I think a lot of people get from Roosevelt is action. He wanted to try to do something. The big brains had ideas, and he went to the brain trust, and they tried some of them and scrapped other ones. So when we talk about things in our later class, tomorrow, we're going to talk about how this is all going to be wrapped up in something known as the New Deal. So what's your task? Your task is to take a look at this video. And after you've seen the video, I have some Chromebook questions for you. I'd also like you to watch the attachments. And then also, I'm available on Google Hangouts. I may not be there live all the time, but feel free to send me a message, concerns. You can ask me how I'm doing. I hope you're doing great. Tell me what's going on with you guys. I'm looking out right now, and it's snowing pretty hard out the window. But, that's what we're living with here. Remember these times. These are going to be some times, and I'm hoping we're not going to have a Great Depression. But I'm hoping that, we will bounce back quickly, but it's very uncertain right now. And the government is trying to act, and they're having some disagreements, and that's unfortunate. So we'll tune in again tomorrow. Look for a Gib TV tonight. I'm trying to arrange an interview with a very special guest. We'll see if they have the guts to show up. But we'll take a look at that later. So I hope you guys are having a good day. We miss you, and get that 8 Blue homework done. I've got a lot. A lot of you are doing your job, but a lot of you aren't. And those that aren't need to get off your butts, spend 20 minutes on this, and get going. It's not a lot. It's a lot less than if you were at school. So I'm counting on you. Okay? All right. See you later.